All right, welcome. And we are here with Richard Matthews, professional engineer from Cérvelo. Richard, welcome.
Welcome.
Honestly, thank you so much for showing up.
No problem. It's always fun to do stuff like this.
We were keeping our fingers crossed. We were like, are they actually going to come?
Yeah, very exciting. It's the Flat Out Fever podcast again.
Yes, Flat Out Fever episode 86, I guess it'll be. Yes.
Yeah. 86, 87, something like that.
We're here with Richard. Richard, you are the senior composites engineer at Cérvelo.
That's correct.
Cérvelo, if I just can do a quick introduction. Yeah, like,
look at that beautiful bicycle.
We have a bunch of British, a big chunk of our audience is from Britain.
Oh yeah, so they all appreciate this.
They'll definitely recognize us. So this, you British people, is the bike that competed in Rio, and you guys made it specifically for Team JB, right? GB,
that's
right?
Yes, yeah. That's correct.
And so this is the bike that went to the Olympics. So that's how high-end Cérvelo is. Cérvelo does just mainly like the highest end of
we
bikes.
We only do high-end bikes, right? We start about $2,500. It's our cheapest bike.
Yeah, it's
more than motorcycles.
Some.
But this is the kind of stuff that you guys do, and you guys work with primarily carbon fiber.
Only carbon fiber.
and this is, frankly, why we're here, and I guess that's a bit of the F1 connection. For me particularly, I remember finding out about Cérvelo a few years ago in an article, I think, that the Global Mail put out, right, or something like that, that basically described how before you guys, for some reason, no other bike company thought, hey, instead of starting with the bike, let's start with engineering. And then parting from engineering and really thinking every single bit of the bike through, come up with the best bike possible. Mm-hmm. And it's made here in Toronto. Well, you guys are from here, from Toronto.
Yes.
Designed here in Toronto.
Designed here in Toronto. Some pieces are made here. Some pieces are made other places.
Can you talk a bit about that? Like, how? Like, what's your approach? You guys approach when it comes to designing a bike?
Yeah, I mean, we're really an engineering first company. That's always been our goal. We were founded by two engineers, Phil and Gerard, who went to McGill.
Nice.
And actually, our first bike was called the Baraki. They built it in 1993, and it was a crazy looking bike back then. And they did the first test driving of that bike on the Montreal F1 track at midnight.
Nice.
They snuck out the bike in the back of a trunk of a car and drove out to the track one night and rode around the track to test ride it.
Illegally?
I don't know. I wasn't there. I can't say. So, you know, we've always been involved with engineering and you know, high-end bikes and speed, making things faster and better. Mm-hmm. And so they started with that crazy bike. And it was a really crazy-looking bike. I don't have a picture actually with me, but you can look it up later and find it online for your viewers. But at the time, most of the bikes in the industry, like road racing bikes, were all just steel, regular old round tube steel bikes. Mm-hmm. From, you know, hadn't changed much since the 30s or 40s, really, right? And so a lot of the bikes were done by artisans, guys who were frame builders and who built bikes and knew from experience how to build bikes with steel.
By banging metal together.
Yeah, right? You cut the tubes, you weld it all up, or you braze it, you know, with lugs and things. And that was still in the 90s how things were done. Mm-hmm. And when they tried to sell, Gerard and Phil tried to sell the first bike, they made it for a rider, Ivan Basso. Johnny Bugno. Sorry, Italian names all messed up. And they said, we don't want to, you know, we made this to be fast and to be cool. They were in aerodynamics at school and things. And they tried selling it or giving it to his bike supplier. And it was an Italian company. And they said, no way, anyone's going to ride this. It's like, bikes are steel and made in Italy. That's a bike. Bikes are not this carbon fiber thing.
Yeah.
So forget it. So that's what they said. Okay, well, we'll start a company then and start making some better bikes because nobody else wants to do this. So at the time they started, everything was really kind of very much so steel and typical bikes. There was some innovation in the late 90s in road bicycles, mm-hmm, before UCI put in new rules. So UCI is the governing body for road bike racing, mm-hmm, kind of like the FIA. And in 2000, they started to see some crazy bikes coming up that were a little different, and they didn't want that. They wanted the bikes to be normal. And they put in these rules that you have to have a regular shaped bike.
Yeah.
So typical, I don't like this bike where we have a double diamond frame.
A triangle, yeah. Two triangles.
Two triangles, right, basically. And that is required by the UCI rules. That bike still meets those rules.
So wait, hang on a second. I want to get acquainted with the jargon. We call that the double diamond shape?
Double diamond shape. This is the double diamond shape bicycle.
All right.
No, there's different tubes on the bike. There's the down tube, top tube, head tube, seat tube. I'm going to get chain stays and seat stays.
Cool.
The bottom brackets where the pedals and crank go.
Yeah.
It's where the weight, your body weight basically hangs off
on there and on the seat. And then you have some weight on the bars as well.
Cool.
Right. And the fork attaches to the wheel, and you have wheels back here. And so those are the parts of a bike.
That basic shape is what they wanted.
That's what they wanted. They wanted it to look like a typical old bike. They didn't want these crazy new shapes coming in.
You're like wing shaped aerodynamic.
At the time, people were trying aerodynamics, right? That was all about it. Because, you know, think about it. Aerodynamics is very important. Like, obviously, you know, from F1, it's the thing.
Yes.
On a bike, it's a little bit less because human power is a much more important factor. Mm-hmm. But aerodynamics is still, when you're riding along, 80% of the work you're doing is overcoming air resistance.
You wouldn't wear a shirt like this.
You wouldn't wear a baggy, flappy shirt.
with buttons.
You were one of those. So most of the work you're doing is air resistance. Like, there's a little bit of rolling resistance from the tires. There's some frictional drag from the components. But most of the work you're doing is pushing air out of the way, which is the same with cars and everything else. And that's why, of course, in F1, for a given power, aero is the number one thing. You go faster with more aero, right? So bikes is the same thing. It's less because on the bike, you also have a rider. Right, and the rider is a much bigger thing than the bike, and a much, you know, less arrow-shaped thing generally than the bike.
He's a bit arrow negative.
Yes. So most of the drag on a bike is the rider. About 75% to 80% is the rider.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
But still, 20-25% of the drag is the bike and all the components, the wheels and everything.
So I guess that's why they say you got to have the biker body, like skinny but thick legs, I guess.
Yeah, well, that's part of it. It's also about the power, because you have to put a lot of power out and then weight.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's only 20-25% of the aero in the bike, but it's still, that's 25%, right? When you're at the top level of the sport, when you're racing, you know, fractions of a second, win the Tour de France, right? Mm-hmm. Then every, you know, fraction of a watt or energy you can save makes a difference. So that's why we started getting into aero bikes. So we started early on from our first bikes in the 96-97 time frame were aerodynamic shaped bikes. They were back then aluminum, but we used airfoil shapes from NACA airfoil shapes from aerodynamic kind of from NASA and aerodynamic theory.
Nice.
So that started that ball rolling. We were like the first ones in the industry who really had bikes that met the UCI rules, the new rules at double diamond shape, but still were aerodynamic.
Nice. I guess back in the day, there was a lot of use of aluminum, as there is still today. Some bikes, some components of F1 cars are still made of aluminum.
Yeah,
little ones though. but back then, it was like the whole front wing or whatever. Like they had that honeycomb inside.
Yep.
Yeah. Like, do you guys use any of that? Like,
we've looked into it. All of our bikes are hollow, right? You can see from some of the things here. Right.
Yeah.
So honeycomb core. I'll sit back here and talk. Yeah. A honeycomb core, what it does is it makes a sandwich structure. So if you think about, you know, structural analysis 101, when you're bending something, the wider, the deeper it is, the stiffer it is, right? You think we have a thin, flat thing, and you try a piece of aluminum, you try and bend it, it's very, you can bend it easily. When you have a very wide, thick thing, it's harder to bend. So a honeycomb core basically fills in the space. It makes it thicker to give you more stiffness, but at low weight.
Adds a little weight.
Yeah. It adds a little weight. It's it has to do with the manufacturing process. We use nothing inside, which is air, which is lighter than honeycomb. So you tend to use that. There have been bikes built with honeycomb cores. The same reason. It depends on the manufacturing process. Often honeycomb cores are used.
The cost in the end of the day.
Yeah. Honeycomb cores are used in aerospace and in automotive when you often use an autoclave to mold parts. Mm-hmm. So an autoclave is basically a giant pressure vessel that's also heated and has vacuum.
Actually, I was hoping that this would come up a little later on, because I did want to get into, because a lot of people, the autoclave, if you're watching you know, an F1 documentary, really anything that works with carbon fiber composites, at one point it has to hit the autoclave, right? And an autoclave, but there's an autoclave involved in some part of the process sometimes.
In lots of the parts, F1 and aerospace, very much so.
Yeah.
Our bike's not always.
Depends on, I guess, the final stiffness you're looking for, and
it comes down to manufacturing. It comes down to how you want to make it. So if you look at these bikes, right, this bike is hollow, mm-hmm. right? So an autoclave, basically, if you put a piece in an autoclave, it makes pressure on the outside of the part. So it'll squish down the part, the material from the outside.
Okay.
So if you have something that's got called a male tool, so the tool is the same. Say I made a tool that was the same shape as the bike on the inside and put the carbon fiber on the outside of it.
Oh, like
then the autoclave would crush the carbon fiber to that.
Okay.
All of our parts are made in female tools. So the part is negative.
Inside of full mold or some sort of mold.
So you have a full huge mold, and basically the shape of this frame is the hollow structure inside the tool. Mm. And so in that case,
you cook it
we
want
to push it from the inside to the out.
Yeah.
And so we use, we call bladder molding. So we use like an airbag or can be like a silicone latex balloon almost, but it's custom made in the shape of the part. Mm. You put it inside the frame, blow it up with air pressure, and that pushes the carbon to the tool, and then it's cured. So the autoclaves are used generally, if you look at how F1 does stuff, the parts are made on a male tool. So they'll make a male shape that's the shape of the wing they want.
Like a mold. It looks like on the outside, right? Like
exactly. And then they put carbon on top of that. Then they put some vacuum bags around it, put it in autoclave, and the autoclave pushes the carbon onto that piece, mm-hmm. heats it up, cures it, comes out solid, and you take it off. So autoclaves are usable for things like that where you want mold on the outside. So
you're kind of essentially baking the tension into the fiber.
It's like pressuring it pressure
on
cooker.
The outside. Pressure cooker. It's exactly what it is. It's not a pressure cooker. Pressure from the outside. For our stuff, because it's all hollow, we want to generally do it from the inside.
Nice. Right. Okay.
So we don't usually use autoclaves.
Is it cooked in atmospheric pressure then, or is it in a vacuum?
So it's a vacuum and heated. And the pressure on the outside. So it's very complex. That's why autoclaves are very expensive. It's like it costs millions of dollars for an autoclave. We don't even have an autoclave in Toronto. Too expensive.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
See, it looks like almost like a submarine.
It's a giant pressure vessel.
yeah.
It's a giant pressure vessel, right? And they'll do whatever, 6, 7, 8, 10, 12, 14 atmospheres, right? So a lot of pressure.
Yeah.
That pushes the carbon, or the, pushes the, you know, whatever material you're using down onto the tool. And you want that pressure was what molds it. With their airbag method, bladder method, we actually can get higher pressures. We can put 160, 180, 200 PSI into a balloon or a bladder. There's also tricks to make it work right.
Now you need the pressure for the carbon fiber to set?
Can
we call it setting?
No, it sets by the temperature.
Okay.
It does set. It's basically, so I was going to give you, I haven't given you my, I'll give you my two-minute carbon fiber lesson.
Yeah, we'll
get
to
that in a minute. Okay, we'll get to that in a minute.
Yeah, we got on a tangent.
Okay.
You've listened to our show, I guess, a
yes,
little bit.
Yes,
we do go on tangents.
I did notice that.
Okay, well, let's go back to what we were talking about, and I guess,
yes.
Why don't we talk about this bike that you have on the screen right now.
So the reason we brought this bike up, this is the T5 GB.
Yeah.
So this was a bike specially made for the British Olympic team at Rio this year. They won 11 medals in the track, 6 mm-hmm. gold medals, cleaned up in the medal count, which was really good. They were very successful with it.
Incredible.
It was a super rushed project. We did it in 6 months. And there's actually 6 sizes of bike, 7 sizes of bike in that, plus other parts. So it was a lot of stuff to make.
Wow.
So in doing that project, we know we couldn't go to our regular suppliers because of the extreme mm-hmm. time limitations. So in fact, this bike was made by a number of suppliers in the UK that are all motorsport, primarily Formula One suppliers.
Really?
Okay. So the bike here, it's you see the bike there too. Yeah. It's obviously nice. Now, like,
so you're talking about they are you're licensing the actual manufacture of these parts from fiber to finished part.
We're not licensed, but we purchase it. We have a supplier who makes the parts for us. We send the design.
You send that
So this is what we start with, a CAD design.
Yeah.
Right. This is 3D model we do in the computer. Mm-hmm. And that's based on, you know, we can get into later aerodynamics and everything mm-hmm. else we do.
Yeah.
But, you know, we come up with this design, and then we find a manufacturer who can help us make it, especially mm-hmm. for this project where it was really, really short term.
There it is.
Well, what happened there? I lost some.
If,
So these are the guys in the UK. Some FEA, so you can do an analysis to look at structure and strength. But here is some of our CFD analysis.
Yeah, we'll get into that a little bit later. Yeah.
But you can see here, this is one of the bikes we made. So this company that makes the frame is called Lentus, and they're quite a big supplier to a lot of F1 companies.
Oh, yeah.
A lot of other motorsport stuff as well. And so they were critical to us to turning around quickly. One of the big things was the tools. So you can see that's the tool there. It's carbon fiber tool. Oh. So often for our bikes, like for instance, this bike here that's made in California, we make an aluminum tool. And so the tool is, as I said before, a negative.
The negative mold.
You fill it's stuff, outside of the frame.
And then you fill it up with some sort of a balloon.
Like a wax paper and then a carbon fiber type.
So we put, so this tool here, you can't quite see it too well. But you can say, I can't see what I'm pointing at. Is there a mouse up there? Can you see it on the screen?
You can see the cursor there.
See it over here.
Using the mouse, you can see the cursor.
So this part in here is like kind of the where the frame actually is. Right, and so we put carbon fiber in that tool. Mm-hmm. Sheets of carbon fiber. I'll explain. Oh no, man, we've lost. It's going too fast.
I know what's going on here. The thing is that the mouse itself is super sensitive. So you kind of have to either click it or if you start to move around it.
I won't touch the mouse. Yeah. I'll use that. All right. So they put carbon in the tool, in both halves of the tool, and then we put. Balloons, basically latex bladders that are custom molded to the shape of the part inside, close the tool
and crank the pressure.
It goes in autoclave to push the tool halves together, but then the air pressure blows up the carbon, pushes the carbon to the edge of the tool.
Pressure both sides,
and then you heat it and it cooks. Comes out solid.
This is interesting that you brought up these people from the UK that do this. We hear over and over and over in F1 that, like, Flavio Briatore, they used to own one of the teams back in the day. Flavio. So the old Flavio, like, he's adamant that Ferrari has to move to Britain because, and, like, here's his argument, that apparently the British are the only ones that have, like, this kind of expertise. Like,
I wouldn't say they're the only ones, but there's a huge concentration of suppliers who have exactly this expertise. So when we knew we were doing this bike for Team GB, we only had 6 months to do it. We knew we'd have to have someone who could do it fast. F1, I mean, their typical work
is yesterday.
Is they get it on Friday and they deliver it on Monday, right? Yeah. Like 3 days to turn around parts, including tooling, right? So that's how they were able to work for us. Like these tools were made in weeks, even sometimes a few days to make the tools. Compared to if you make the machine aluminum tool that's solid, you can take 6 weeks or 7 weeks to make that. So
like nonstop
on the CNC machine, big chunks of aluminum just grinding it out from the slab, or steel, right? In this case, with the carbon tools, they actually make the tools. They CNC a foam piece and lay up carbon on it to make a carbon tool, which is really nice and fast. You can do it fast. So in the UK, there's a lot of companies who do this because there's a lot of Formula One companies there. So there's lots of different businesses who have different expertises, but. When we knew we had to get someone who could do carbon fiber molding fast for us and very high quality, we went right to the UK, also being a UK Team GB bike. We know it didn't hurt. So we talked to a lot of suppliers.
Yeah.
There's a lot of suppliers there to choose from. And, we chose the ones we did, but there's lots of others. So I think, people in Italy can do this. People in other places in the world can do this. We can do it in California. We can do it some places in Canada. But just the sheer number of suppliers who specialize in this area in the UK really makes it advantageous for that.
The competition brings you the speed that you need as well.
Yeah. Yeah. There's more competition. There's more people who can do stuff. If you get stuck, you can go to some other company, or people are, kind of fighting to get the business. So they're, they want more business. Right. So it's, certainly we noticed that there's a lot of companies there that do a lot of stuff. Business you've never heard of, like these guys at Lentus, who are great guys, but you've never heard of them, but they make stuff for all the big F1 teams.
That's cool.
And other suppliers we use as well. We use another company called KS that did some of the handlebars for us. And they same thing. They make lots of parts for other companies too. But you never heard about them. But it's all kind of behind the scenes. Because the same thing like us. We do all the engineering and development. But we don't actually make a lot of the pieces. Mm-hmm. We have suppliers and good partners we work with to make the pieces. But same thing with F1 teams. F1 teams don't make all the pieces. They have a huge range of suppliers.
Yeah.
And they bring them all together and put them together, and they have suppliers they can work with and trust.
It's right? The nature of the world we live in today. Exactly. Like supply chains today, like,
it's huge,
span right? around the world, yeah. as opposed to back, I guess, even back to like the 80s and 90s, it used to be that you got everything sourced from the one country.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's all over. One place. Now it's everywhere. Right. So yeah, same thing.
Before we move off of this, I was kind of joking there, but seriously, so with a mold like that, you have the two negatives back to back, you have your carbon inside the the bladder in between. What kind of anti-stick would you put on that? Would
the carbon put a special mold release coating on the tool before
some
they put
sort of cooking
in.
Spray type?
It's usually brushed in. Oh, okay. It's like
it's a high temperature.
It's a Teflon, crazy chemical based thing that they brush in the tool that prevents it from sticking to it and release it. So it'll release out of the tool when you're done.
Just even looking at that picture and what you just said, like, I get the feeling, and you know, from everything that I've looked into, working with carbon fiber parts of it can be like quite a manual process.
It's entirely manual. That's what people don't get. People think, oh, it's like a, you know, if I get something on aluminum, I can just put it in the CNC machine, push go, and the robot makes it for me, right?
Yeah.
This bike here is made in California. There's over 500 individual pieces of carbon fiber.
Wow.
Every single one of them put in by hand. Now they're cut with we have a CNC cutter to cut the pieces out. Someone puts every single piece in. So that's one of the reasons that our bikes are A, expensive, and B, made in different places where, because labor is the driving factor in bikes. By far, the number one cost is labor because it's all manual time.
Yeah.
If you have a car, cars are cheap because they've absolutely minimized hand time, right?
Right.
Almost everything that can be done by robots is done by robots.
I've actually worked on installing robots in the Ford car factory here.
There you go.
You see it. You can see, like, nobody works on this whole line. Like, I was there for a couple of weeks for a shutdown. We replaced a bunch of human jobs with about 15 robots. I got to work on the PLCs for it, and just seeing that everything's going
to... It's amazing. So we're not there robots. Yet. People are trying to make carbon fiber done robotically. In aerospace, they do it a lot on things like wings, airplane wings.
Yeah.
Right? Airplane wing is like 300 feet long, right? They have these giant tape laying machines that go up and down and lay down the carbon fiber. And that works for that because it's, you know, relatively simple shapes, flat, lots of volume, right? Those wings are like, I don't know, they can be this thick carbon fiber. They can be many inches thick carbon fiber.
50,000 liters of fuel inside.
Yeah. But something like this, right? There's no robot that can go in here and take a piece of carbon fiber and stretch it around in here or fit it in, you know, in these little spots here yet. People are working on it, but it's not happened yet. So this is still done entirely manually. And F1 is pretty much the same thing. It's quick turn, right? You have no time, so you don't have time. Automation works great when you can program it and make millions of them, right? That's when it works out well because you do it. You spend a year programming it, but then it takes 30 seconds each time, right? On low volume stuff like F1 and like our bikes, it's not worth it because you spend so much money to program it. You make 25 bikes or, you know, two parts, and then you'd be off to the next one. So manual still makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
And it's a lot of operator skill. It's a lot of operator skill. These guys doing the layup, putting the carbon fiber in. We'll talk more in a minute about carbon fiber and how it actually works, but it's difficult.
Right on. Well, I guess that's why you need like that level of expertise. And it's not easy to find, I suppose.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's difficult. The other thing they did, these are this company called.
That's what it looks like inside. People are like,
this is the paint booth. This is a company called Silversone Paint. Silversone Paint Technologies. This is the very first project they've done that's not Formula One.
Really?
Oh, they're based at Silverstone. All they do is paint Formula
One.
It's Silverstone, right?
Not even race cars, just F1 cars?
Just F1 cars. Not even race cars. Only F1 cars. They were super keen. They had worked with Lentus before because they worked on F1 cars together.
Yeah.
And so Lentus said, we have these guys who can paint. We'll ask them if they're interested. And they're super keen because it was a Team GB. You know, for them, it's a big thing. Olympics, everything. They were keen on it. But it's amazing, the technology in the paint.
Just the paint.
So these guys, this bike is painted with, they developed this new special paint that when they painted the first bikes for us in Rio, they hadn't used yet. The first race was in say, not Malaysia, Singapore. Singapore this year was the first race they used this paint that's on this bike.
Whoa.
For F1. But that whole bike, every bit of paint on that bike weighs 25 grams.
All of it.
All the paint. Wow. Because usually when you have white, especially white colors, white is heavy. You have to put multiple layers on and primers and everything else normally. Mm-hmm. It's also that it's got like sparkly metallic fades and things, right? Normally on a typical bike we did, that would weigh probably 100 to 200 grams for that paint.
It looks beautiful. Look at that.
But this is 20. So this is like, so even the paint's high tech on this. But again, we had these guys because they were F1 guys. They had the technology.
Right.
Because F1, you know, paint is absolutely critical as well. Right. Obviously, you have a nice F1 car. You got to paint it to put your sponsors on there.
Of course.
But if you add 2 pounds of paint to your car, you can't, right? So these guys, that's what they do. They make lightweight paint jobs. So they were really good. Of course, you pay for it.
Yeah. Absolutely. I just one quick thing. I mean, I know that maybe people might be confused so where Mike is. Mike is in the camera right now. If anybody is watching, Mike, any question you got, feel free to like shoot it. Don't worry, interrupt.
I'll make sure you know.
Okay.
So I don't know what this is. More some stiffness testing we're doing at the on the bike. So I brought that bike up just because I guess the F1 links, right?
Yeah.
We really wanted to work with a company that could, companies that could do fast turnaround, but were knowledgeable. These guys were great. We could, you know, they understood carbon fiber. They understood how to make stuff better. And what I thought was really interesting on this whole project, you know, everyone looks at bikes and says, "Oh, that's a bike. It's really simple, right? It's easy." We had all three of those companies, plus the team. So the Team GB has a technical liaison. His name is Tony Purnell. You may have heard of him before. He used to be ahead of, it was before Red Bull. He started Red Bull.
Yeah, I was going to say, he's been in F1.
He's ex-F1 guy.
Yeah.
He was the head of the technical department, Team GB. So he kind of was, we reported, or we gave the bikes to him. He's super knowledgeable about stuff. But there's a video of him being interviewed for this project. And him and all the other guys together, every one of them said independently that this is way harder than anything they'd ever done in F1.
Oh, wow.
So it's, you know, because we have so little weight to deal with.
Yeah.
You know, the wall thickness on this bike, it can be down as low as 0.5 millimeter.
Wow.
Right?
Yeah, I was looking at this piece right here. That's incredible.
That's one of the thicker parts.
I could probably, like, I don't want to break it, but I could stand
probably,
on this, right?
Yeah, you probably
can't break this. Yeah. I don't want to try with my hand because it probably slice me and I have to go to the hospital.
But yeah,
but you could stand on this easy, right?
That's one of the thicker parts of the bike, right? If you look at some of the
here, right? Do you know offhand how much this can hold?
Thousands of pounds,
couple hundred.
Probably.
Thousands?
Yeah, probably.
I would have guessed a few hundred.
I haven't tested it, but I'm sure. I mean,
that's less than 0.5 millimeter. That's incredible.
No, that's probably a millimeter.
Maybe.
That looks like a millimeter.
That's incredible.
1.5, but yeah. And that's only woven, so we'll get back into more detail of carbon fiber later. But yeah, bikes have very little extra room, right? Because, you know, riding a bike, you pick your bikes up, right? You know, if you pick a bike that weighs 30 or 40 pounds, like, oh, I got to lug this, I got to ride up a hill, right? It's like extra weight.
Yeah.
So weight is absolutely critical on a bike.
Yeah.
In a car, where you have a motor, you know, obviously F1, still every gram matters, but it's a little bit less so. And you have, you know, in racing, of course, you have weight limits too. Same thing as UCI bikes, we have limits to minimum weights you can go to, so you can't go below that.
I wanted to say that some of your racing bikes are below, like for Le Mans or I guess the Olympics, the UCI limit, your bikes are below and you have to actually add weight for the competitors.
This bike in particular. So the UCI limit is 6.8 kilos for the whole bike. So that bike there,
including your seats, brakes,
actually a little heavy. It was almost 7 kilos for that bike. It was a couple hundred grams over where we really ideally want it to be. That's the same weight limit in road racing. This bike here is raced, we've raced it in the Tour de France, Giro d'Italia, things like that. And there's one story where this bike weighs about 600, it depends on the size, 600 to 700 grams. And to race it, they had to add at one point almost as much weight as the bike frame in dead weight. So we had about 400 grams of dead weight to get it up to the UCI minimum.
But it gives you the same sort of advantage, I assume, as an F1 car being underweight, is you can put the ballast where you want.
Exactly.
You can balance
the weight down low, right down here,
right,
it helps a little bit.
Right near the
Although
rope.
It's not perfect, because extra weight in the frame and carbon will give you more stiffness. Extra dead weight here is just dead weight. Right? So there's no stiffness benefit. So we built this bike because people who buy this expensive bike don't race it, they ride it uphill. Yeah, train they want it as light as possible. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it's stiff enough. We could have made it stiffer at the UCI minimum weight, but that wasn't the goal. This book was absolute minimum weight. Yes.
I have a pretty stiff
triathletes would like that kind of people would like this kind of stuff.
No, that's next on the list.
Oh yeah, okay.
We'll show you the next picture.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Look at that's what? So what's
this,
going on there?
This is the P5X.
This is the P5X. This is our new bike. This is actually a cheap piece of it.
This guy right here.
I think. See, there you go. Watch your fingers.
I'm gonna be. I'm bleeding now. I got a piece of fiber sticking out of my finger.
Pull that out of your finger.
I get the social media.
You can't sue me for injuries.
No. You did warn me.
I did warn you.
But maybe you can pull that out. Should be. Yeah. This is awesome. The storage.
So that was the whole point of this bike is storage. This is for triathlon. So triathletes like Ironman.
Yeah.
So we launched this at Ironman World Championships in Kona in October. They'll go 112-mile bike ride, right? So, and they have to carry everything with them. They can't take any support. They can take some water.
Water, right?
But that's it. So they have to have
water
flat kits.
Extra tube, maybe.
We have tubes in there, flat kits for replacement. You can't take help repairing your flat tire. You've got to have all yourself.
Right.
Self-supported. So they carry a crazy amount of stuff on there. So we designed this bike. We spent a bunch of time on this bike, the P5X, designing it for the triathletes. Triathletes worry about weight a little less. The courses generally aren't as hilly. Mm. It's more about aerodynamics because they're in the British bike. They have the aerodynamic bars, right? So you sit down and lean down because it's a more aerodynamic position when you're leaned over.
Yeah.
You're sitting up like this, it's more comfortable.
Yeah.
But the air hits you in the chest
right.
and slows you down. Right. So they're in that air position with all the stuff on the bike. So that bike is a different target than this bike, ultra lightweight bike, or even the track bike, right? But this came about because triathlon isn't governed necessarily by the UCI rules to have double diamonds. And so in recent years, there's been a bit of a push away from UCI legal shapes in triathlon to non. And this is the first attempt for us at a non-UCI legal bike.
As a designer, is that like designing, like coming up with something like this, is it more rewarding to you? Like actually like not being constrained by the rules?
A little bit, yeah. It gives you more freedom, but it's also harder. We talked about this when we gave the presentation on this bike. And, you know, when you have UCI rules that basically they have boxes with a double diamond shape. And basically you got to fill in the boxes, right? It's like, okay, I know where to start. Someone says, make a new bike. Okay, it's easy to start there. Mm-hmm. With this bike, we said, we're not going to do the UCI rules. We're going to do whatever we want. But now it's like, where do you start? You have this blank sheet of paper and you can do anything, right? So now it's like, oh, it's almost harder to start because you could do anything. So I was going to show for this. Yeah. A little bit. So this is something we talked about, you know, in your notes, you're talking about the process. But this is, for this bike, particularly because it's a strange bike, we had an interesting process. We did a lot of sketches early on. Right. And this is our lead designer, David, did all these. He designed the shapes of this. And so I'll flip through. But there's a ton of different shapes. We didn't come up with the idea of we wanted to make the bike like it looks now. We said, wide open to any shape.
Just any.
Which shape is more beneficial for different reasons for where you put your water bottles, aerodynamics, strength, storage, where you put the rest of your stuff, your tools, your food, everything else you need, right? So we didn't limit ourselves to those kind of things. We had all these, David had these crazy ideas and shapes for what we could do. Just, you know, start with hand sketches, of course.
Yeah.
But then we go into CAD, right? So in this case, actually, it turns out for the P5X, we wanted it to work with round bottles. So some bikes have, and triathlon bikes have built-in water storage. Mm-hmm. Like water tanks or bladders.
Like a bladder built into the shape of the bike.
Or some of them have actually a rigid box that's molded into the frame of the bike. Which is kind of cool because the water is aerodynamic, right?
Yeah.
But what happens is when you get to a race and you're getting water, which you need to get on the bike, they give you round bottles. So if you have a funny bladder, something you have to fill up your bladder. And so we wanted to make sure that people had the option of running a round bottle. So that was we did a lot of research, like a whole year of research in this bike before we designed it, learning what triathletes do, how they use a bike, that kind of stuff. So we really went back to the basics. But that was one of the key things everyone said. We wanted to be able to use round bottles. Okay. That's easy. So
you don't want to kill the arrow as soon as they stick one on the bike either, too.
Exactly. Right? So those key things that turned out was that the round bottle really drove the design because you have to be able to access the bottle. But there's a lot of places you can on the bike where you can't put the round bottle because it'll hit your legs when you're pedaling. So we did a bunch of studies on where you could put the bottle. And so, you know, we had some different ideas, but you can see that we had different shapes about where the bottle would fit. We basically designed the frame around the bottle. These are some of the options, but this is the one that worked best.
Okay.
Was to move the material kind of above the bottle. And yeah, it's also, you know, obviously we analyzed these structurally and aerodynamically and everything else. And chose the best overall. And this is the one that kind
of... This would be more the best compromise of having a bottle or not having a bottle. It's not affecting the bike really either.
Yeah,
way.
You can see that the bike is very wide.
Getting the same aero advantage whether the bottle's there or not.
There's a small penalty for the bottle, but it's much less. Okay. Then on this bike, there's a huge penalty for the bottle.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Right? And that bike, see, the bottle goes there.
It sits right here.
It's not much wider.
It's about the same width as...
Than that part of the frame, yeah. So it helps a lot, yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. There's actually two positions in this bike. We have a little storage box.
Awesome. You can see exactly.
You can see the bottle goes horizontally. And the horizontal bottle is more aerodynamic because it's
angled
that way, so the air flows over it better rather than running the angle.
Cool.
So there's a bunch of stuff. So obviously we came up with this design in the end in the computer, but so we always, you know, each bike we do is different and we design it based on what the requirements are for that person. It's, all of our bikes are only road bikes and racing bikes, pretty much. But we have, you know, regular road racing bikes like the UCI, like a Tour de France bikes, right?
Mm-hmm.
That would be this bike. Track bikes like that one, and then triathlon bikes like the P5X.
And that coupled with a huge following of people that basically swear by your bikes.
we've got a pretty loyal customer base. It's good. I mean, not huge. We're a small company still.
Yeah.
But we have a very loyal customer base, so it's nice that way.
I saw one on the road in Mississauga last week.
Yeah. You see quite a few in Toronto. It's our home territory, right? And we get
now that I'm aware, I'm like, oh, it's
you enough. See more than when you're aware of them.
What is this?
So you want to talk about CFD, because I know that was in one of your earlier questions.
Should we get right into it now?
We can do that. So
can we, before we move on, one last question, just about, because you're talking about the molding already.
Yeah.
This piece of foam inside here, is that just because this is a prototype piece, or is that part of the,
so this bike, how this is actually piece molded is made? That way. We mold that, that's a silicone rubber in there.
So when you
and it's,
ride this we, bike, you pull that out, I guess.
When we finish making the bike, you pull it out. In this case, this is a prototype. We didn't pull that out. It got stuck in there.
You can't really, I guess we can't show on the camera. You wouldn't
be able to
see,
see there. But
oh,
see that,
there's a molded
that
foam.
Kind of triangular bit sticks up there. Mm-hmm. Again, we have airbags everywhere else, but getting another airbag to go up into that corner was difficult. And so we use a piece of silicone. And silicone, when you heat it, expands. So we put the carbon fiber in the tool, put the silicone inside, and then the silicone expands and crushes the fiber, carbon fiber to the tool. Same as the airbag would do.
So instead of the bladder, you use the
silicone?
Well, use silicone.
Both, the combination. Because the silicone, the problem with silicone is it doesn't change. You can't, getting it out is hard, right?
Yeah.
Silicone, it expands when you cure it, but when it cools down again, it's the same kind of size it was before. Mm-hmm. And so it's not easy getting that out. The only reason we have it on this bike, because we have that huge opening for the door for storage, you can reach in there and pull that silicone piece out through that.
Right.
Normally, on a bike like this, if you put silicone in here, you couldn't get it out. And it'll be really heavy and weigh a lot.
Yeah.
But we use a combination of bags and silicone. But that green piece is leftover silicone just because that was a prototype.
Yeah, that's the kind of stuff I'm interested in.
Yeah,
how did you make this?
With that, yeah, it's kind of cool.
Yeah. So going to the CFD and things like finite element analysis, is that when we started to look into this, and just to give our listeners a bit of a background, the same background that I gave you, the FIA is looking into tightening the rules when it comes to the usage of wind tunnels.
Yes.
Now, they're doing this because there's been a huge outcry from the teams, that especially the ones at the lower end of the grid, saying that, you know, F1 is getting too expensive. And it is.
Sure.
It absolutely is.
No question.
And they cannot be competitive because it's too expensive. So in an effort to get the regulator to, like, come in and, like, help them save costs, they say, you know what, one of the biggest things that we have to worry about is the wind tunnel. Too many people, like, there's teams that have their own wind tunnel, so they don't have to worry about it. But, you know, so because of that, they want to really push more into designing all the parts into computers. And at one point, teams like Force India and Sauber were even floating the idea of just getting rid of wind tunnel altogether. And just doing everything based on CFD, finite element analysis, and all the other stuff.
And it's come out this week, Red Bull is building a new simulator that is tied in to their CFD computer side. So they take their wind tunnel analysis, put it straight into their CFD, test it on the wind tunnel, verify it with the sensors on the track, and they have basically almost a closed loop closed now. Loop yeah. This is Red Bull's new thing is bigger than this room. It's
huge. But
I saw some pictures. It's incredible how the computer technology they're using now for the design.
And looking, just doing a bit of research on Cérvelo, but very preliminary. One of I just found it interesting that one of your little promo videos has somebody saying that you guys use F1 spec CFD.
Yeah, that was an old one. we use the same software that F1 companies use, right? There's
SolidWorks levels of,
well, that's for CFD. It's Star CCM is what we use, and that's a very high end, well known. But other companies use it as well, but it's known in the F1 industry. SolidWorks is typical. F1 not so much. Automotive tends to use more often CATIA and things like that, but SolidWorks is common some of the smaller teams.
For a layman, and just leading up. Up to today, I just tried to go on YouTube, for example, and look up what is CFD, and you find a few lectures of people telling you all kinds of things that doesn't make sense to me. So I guess if you were to tell somebody what is CFD, what's the use for?
So I'll look at two things, CFD and FEA, because they're both kind of linked in and kind of similar, but so they're both, CFD stands for computational fluid dynamics. You don't worry about that, forget it. And FEA stands for finite element analysis, as you mentioned. But they're both, what they are is approximate methods for analyzing things in the computer. So, when we have a bike frame like this bike, we take it, we have to do some tests on it to make sure it's strong enough. So we'll take it and put it in a machine, and we'll put some pedals in it, and we'll push on the pedals until the bike pushes over on its side and push down until it breaks.
Oh, okay.
Right? Whoa. And so we have our own internal standards for what that needs to be in terms of minimum strength, because we know from experience that, okay, if it will withstand X newtons, 2,000 newtons, whatever the number is, then we know it's going to be safe to ride. We also have legally required tests for strength and that we have to pass. So to sell a bike in Europe or in the U.S., you have to pass these minimum strength tests.
And yes, for racing, the UCI, the FIA, has minimum standards for... So front impact.
The UCI doesn't have the standards as much, but they refer to ISO, which is a European standard. The ISO standard is really what drives. But yes, effectively, UCI says you must meet the ISO standards, and ISO says you must meet these strengths. But yes, we have front impact.
You have to do a crash test.
We do a drop test. Yeah,
accidentally crash this into a wall, like your car,
we push a bike, push a fork in here, and we have a 22.5 kilo weight, and we drop it 200 and some odd millimeters down, bang, onto the fork. Can be no damage to the fork or frame.
Oh, okay.
We have other tests. There's a bunch of other tests.
So it'd be if you're riding this after a few beers, accidentally lose control, you should be all
right. Well, that's the thing. With a bike, it's different. A car protects you, right? In your car, and you crash your car, and your bumpers protect you, and you're safe. On a bike, you will fly off the bike at velocities well below what that impact test is.
Okay.
Right? So you still can be injured very easily. The bike doesn't protect you because you're on it,
right
and when you hit something that hard, you will fly off long before the bike breaks. So then you could be injured, you could not be injured. So it's a little different in terms of the bike. You don't want it to break or be broken in such a way that it can hurt you, but at some point you can never protect against all impacts, right?
Right,
you hit something hard enough, it will, no matter what, it will break, right? Even F1 car straight to a concrete wall at 300 kilometers an hour is still probably gonna tub's gonna crash, right? But you design for the best. So the legal requirements, then we design beyond the legal requirements to give us maximum safety, obviously. So we have these requirements for strength that we have to meet. So you test that. It's very easy. You make a part, you test it, right? But that's not a very efficient way of doing stuff, especially when you have short amount of time, like an F1 especially, right? If you had to test every part for strength as you made it, you wouldn't have time. You'd make two parts a year, right? So the computer analysis, basically what it does is it simulates that test in the computer. So finite element analysis simulates structural tests where you put a force on something and look whether it breaks or how much it moves. So we can do that in a real test where we put if I go back, next picture right there. Okay. This is that we call BB incline test.
Oh, okay.
On the bike. So we push down, that big black bar is pushing downwards, straight down on the ball. The ball is on a pedal.
Oh, I see.
And the bike's tilted over because it's worst case when you tilt it over. And we push down with a lot of force until that bike breaks.
Whoa.
Right? And we measure the force. So what we want to do is when we're doing a design, if we have to make and break every single one, it's because ages come with a design.
And expensive.
So the finite element analysis lets us make a model, and that's what this is. This is a finite element analysis model where we take the computer model of it and we basically breaks up into small little pieces and does a lot of math stuff. And you don't have to worry about the details. And you get something like this in the end that tells you kind of where it's going to break or where it needs to be stronger or things like that. So this case, this is showing us stress. And so the red is areas of very high stress. So you can see just around it's hard to see.
So like the
right around down here at the head tube where the bearing is red. So when you do that test, it's going to break there first.
Okay.
So we make sure, and it tells us what load it should break at effectively. So what we can do now with the computer, if that computer test and the FEA matches real life, then we can go and do that. That takes about 30 seconds to run in the computer. So I can now go through and try 100 different frame shapes in a day and test them all in the computer to see which one is best for strength or how it can affect the strength with the computer, with the shape of the bike or the carbon fiber layup or whatever else I want to change.
So earlier in the year and like a couple of races back, we saw the Haas car that at the very high speeds.
Yes.
Parts flying. They didn't do their FEA homework right then.
So this is where I think the important point is that they may have done their FEA homework right, but the critical part with FEA is correlating it to test.
Okay.
Because FEA is by definition, it's an approximation. Mm. It simplifies the theoretical. There's some equations that are correct that, you know, it can take 16 chalkboards and derive these huge equations that tell you the strength and stiffness for any given thing.
Right.
Right. But the FEA model makes approximations on that. Mm-hmm. It makes simplifications. And so the hard part, the FEA, I always say it's funny because you can show it this picture and this picture can be complete garbage, but it still looks nice. Right. Yeah. And so you have to be careful because if you put the wrong numbers in, you can get garbage out, but you can't tell looking at it that it's garbage. Right. Mm. So you have to really, we spend a lot of time correlating our FEA results to our test. So we do a test, we make up a frame or even a simple part, like a tube or a flat plate or a bar. We test it. We make 20 of them, test them all, break them all. We go in the FEA, do the FEA on those. Does it match? Why doesn't it match? We go back and forth. So it's a lot. In the FEA, there's hundreds and hundreds of variables. And so tweaking these variables changes the results. And so we tweak the variables till we see that it matches. Then we do it again with a different shape. We do it again until we get comfortable that, okay, if we do it with these settings on the variables, then we know our FEA will match the bike. And it may only be for certain cases. We have to change those variables if you change from an impact test to a pedaling test to something else, right? Mm-hmm. So it's very complicated. Mm-hmm. And that's where you have an issue is when you don't correlate your FEA to your actual testing. Testing is real. Right, yeah, I made the part. I pushed on it. It broke at this load. This is when it broke. Breaks that, right? Yeah. The FEA is not real. It's approximating the testing. But if you get it correct and you've done some correlation, it's good. So this is where it comes back to what we say with Haas, right? Maybe they did their FEA just fine.
Yeah.
If they didn't correlate their FEA to actual loads or had correlated it differently or had some differences, then the FEA can be garbage. So somebody signed off the FEA and said, oh, yeah, here's the analysis. It looks good. Yeah, it's going to stay on at 200 miles an hour. Good. Check. Make the part. Right? Mm. Someone didn't check in the model. The assumption you made for this and this, which is in an FEA model, is buried somewhere in this huge mathematical thing.
And correlation must be huge. I remember back 2 years ago, correlation was a big buzzword that kept popping up in F1 when they tried to describe why Ferrari wasn't good in 2014. The Ferrari was nowhere. And one big point that I remember, people kept talking about it over and over and over, is the correlation. They just didn't have it right.
They were new to using some of the CFD.
Exactly,
so,
right?
So what I was saying about Red Bull there is that, so they've set up this new loop system, but you see them on the race weekends. They have on the front wing the infrared sensors looking at the tires. They have
those pitot tubes.
The pitot tubes on the sides. The flex monitors that are measuring the wing flex all weekend.
Is that the models?
Correlation, yeah. So they're correlating that to both. And so this is the thing. So FEA is structural. Mm-hmm. CFD is airflow. It's the same thing as CFD is basically a version of FEA, but rather than analyzing a structure, you're analyzing the air around a structure.
So it mimics the wind tunnel, basically.
It mimics anything. It predicts airflow in any situation. You can use it for any fluid flow, really. Yeah. So you can predict flow in pipes and how a valve is going to work in a water pipe, right? Up to, in a wind tunnel, you have a volume of air that's moving. And really, in this case, in the FEA, we model the frame. Mm-hmm. In CFD, we're really modeling the air around the frame.
Right.
Okay.
So the frame is actually the boundary condition, and the air is what you're modeling. And you model the air, and there's equations that predict what the air is going to do, how the fluid is going to flow, mm-hmm. given the boundary conditions it has, the speed it's got, what it's flowing on. So I'll show you a picture here of,
that's a
cool
picture.
See, there's a bunch of CFD pictures. But so airflow is more complicated than stress. Stress and strain are pretty simple. Airflow is a lot more dynamic. Mm-hmm. It happens, changes over time. Generally, like for a load test, it'll be a static test. It's just one load and it stays on it, right? Does it break or not? But CFD is changing over, air is changing over time. It's moving, right? The wheels are spinning. The driver's legs are spinning.
Altitude, temperature as well.
Yeah, everything. Temperature is very key. The density of the air changes. Everything changes. Really? Reynolds number changes. So it's really complicated. So you can see some of the stuff you can get. Pressures. This is a really cool picture of air velocity. This is P5X.
This is CFD.
This is CFD. Okay. So you see the gray, right?
Yeah.
That's the bike and the rider. But in reality, the gray is not the model. The gray is the boundary condition.
Ah.
And the model is
the air in this field.
Flowing, yeah.
So we're modeling the air. And what happens in this picture shows velocities. And it kind of gives you directional sense, too. You can see where the air is going and that kind of thing. So it's very complicated, obviously, right?
So you can see why the one water bottle sits right below the driver's ass area.
Yeah.
It's a negative pressure area.
Exactly, right? That's why water bottles
affect the aerodynamics.
Behind the seat are very, this is one case. There's many, we ran hundreds and hundreds of cases, right? So CFD-A is way more complicated than FEA. Mm-hmm. It's newer, so generally it's less, people understand it less well, but it's also way more computationally intensive. So an FEA model of that frame runs in about 10 seconds or whatever. That's on a single, mm-hmm. we have a 16 core machine at the office.
Yeah, so one is like a desktop that you could
Dell.
$3,000 machine, and I can run on I can run on my home computer, right? You can run on a $2,000 computer if you want. It's fine.
Yeah, like a high-end gaming computer, I guess.
It'll run just fine. Yeah,
something like that.
CFD, this runs on a server called SharkNet, which is hosted by the University of Western Ontario. We run it on 128 cores. and it takes us about 4 hours to do one run.
Wow.
Like how many minutes would that simulate a few seconds of moving through a single...
That's a static simulation where you're basically looking for it to stabilize, but it's running for probably a minute or so. A minute of flow time in four hours.
The next era, I guess, will be the correlation, the CFD, the design right from the beginning, and bringing the testing
of
individual pieces together.
Here you can see. So this is what we do. So we do CFD, mm-hmm. right? But again, it's all about the correlation.
Right.
If we don't know if our CFD is giving us good numbers, it's garbage, right? So we do wind tunnel testing as well, right? So this is, we have this mannequin. So
what scale is our model?
1:1.
Oh, yeah.
That is actually, we call them DZ. It's a laser scan version of Dave Zabriskie. He was the U.S. time trial champion and on our team for a number of years. We laser scanned his body and made a fiberglass covered foam.
And you just use him all the time?
And we use him. but the key thing is repeatability. We can put a real person on the rider in the wind tunnel, but real person is always moving a little bit. Mm. And we're looking for very, very low drag numbers. Yeah. And so basically it gets lost in the noise of the real rider. Although it's more correct. But you get so much variation that you can't see.
Can you tell what's really correct, I guess?
Actually correct. It's the wind tunnel is correct. So the rider is correct, but it's varying like this. But you want to see, for doing designs, you want to look at changing things and see how they affect stuff. So if you have something that affects less amount than the noise, you can't see it with a real rider.
Right.
With the dummy, it's much more accurate. We put him on, use lasers, and line up the same position every time. Mm. And so he's very repeatable.
Okay.
And so we can correlate that test to our CFD. So we spent a lot of time. But what's interesting is that just changing things slightly, he has, for instance, here he's in this time trial position, he has time trial arms. He has different arms that are road riding arms.
Yeah. Okay.
The correlation is completely different for those two cases. So we have to redo all of our correlation CFD when we do that case. So I think the thing here is it's very complicated to correlate CFD to real world wind tunnel results.
Yeah.
And so this is I see that. Like for me, we would not design a bike only in CFD ever.
Really? Okay.
Because I don't think we're ever going to be comfortable enough that we're getting good results.
Is that just the limitation of the technology?
I think it's limitation of technology, but also on a bike, right, a car is more the overall structure is fixed. Mm. And the person is like a thing inside. It's not moving around. Yeah. It's much better. And the overall numbers are much higher. Mm-hmm. Like our drag numbers, we're talking 2,000 grams of drag. We're looking for, like a biking rider here is about 2,500 grams of drag total. That's the drag force pushing backwards. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But we're looking for changes in the order of 5 to 10 grams when we change how a water ball is mounted or how the design feature. Yeah. Right? On an F1 car, it's probably an order of magnitude above that, right? At least, if not more than that. At hundreds of kilometers an hour, there's probably thousands and thousands and probably many kilograms of drag, right? Yeah. And small changes are making changes in the order of, you know, hundreds of grams or, you know, lots more drag, so they can see that more easily. Mm-hmm. So we have to worry about, we're at the noise limit of both measurement error and computational error on CFD for bikes. And so for F1 and for cars, it's so much bigger that it's a little easier for them to do that.
Right. So for you guys, it's not a question of getting a bigger computer, you'll get bigger. No. Okay.
No, the software limitation, process limitations, but also, testing limitations for sure for us. Mm. So it is a factor. But yeah, definitely we always do wind tunnel tests. We always validate with wind tunnel testing. But we understand the cost because, I mean, we go to the wind tunnel. This is the San Diego, it's a low speed wind tunnel, it's called. It's done for low speed airplanes, but they do a lot of bike stuff there now. Mm-hmm. And our tunnel costs are 25 cents a second.
Cool.
For when we're in the tunnel.
Okay.
So, you know, we spent, I think last year we spent $160,000 in the wind tunnel. Wow. That's us. We're not a big company. Right. So you can understand where these F1 teams, like, you can spend a lot of money in a wind tunnel. But I think, you know, when they say they want to get rid of wind tunnels, it's kind of like, I would be a little bit worried because knowing what we know about correlation and stuff.
Yeah.
If you're relying only on CFD, okay, if you've got your CFD dead on and, you know, the parameters don't change for the basic design, then okay. But one thing goes wrong.
The technology is just not really there yet. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's very advanced. It's not so much the technology. It's the, I guess it kind of is technology, but the process limitations, certainly computer power, mm-hmm. right? I'm sure these F1 guys running CFD are running thousands of cores.
They have a limitation. Actually, by the rules, the FIA limits them.
Teraflop
limits.
Yeah. Oh, is there? Okay.
13 teraflops or something like that. So yeah, that's as much computing power that they can use. I don't know what that means, but
that's
trillion floating point operations per second.
It's probably in the hundreds of cores, I'm guessing. Yeah. I don't know. It depends on they're obviously getting better now. But
that's a limit, but not all teams even get close to that. There is one team, though, that they had the brilliant idea back in 2010 or 2009 or something. Richard Branson came to F1 with the Virgin team, and that was his angle.
He wanted to do all computer.
So he maxed out the computing power and was like, "We're just gonna get the computers to do it." Yeah. And that did not work for him.
But it did. Yeah, that's the thing. I think it comes down to that, right? It's all correlation, right? You can get a computer to do whatever, but FEA and CFD will be, you know, garbage in, garbage out. If you don't get your numbers right, you haven't correlated it. It's a great, beautiful picture, right? This looks fantastic.
That does look great.
Right? But it could be completely wrong. You have no idea if it's right or wrong. Right?
It looks cool.
This is the Ghost Rider version of the P5X. You know?
With the finite element analysis, how closely is the technology correlated with carbon design now? Can that tell you, like, okay, you need to add another layer of this specific carbon to here? Because I can see on this that, you know, certain layers are thicker and thinner than other. Yep. You can see four layers on the inside.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't necessarily tell. It doesn't. The smarts isn't in the software. The smarts is in the guys running the software.
It's in guys like you, yeah.
But the
software can make suggestions at this point in time or not yet.
It doesn't yet make suggestions. We have some tools that do optimization that will give you will pick things for you and guide you on things. But there's a lot of human power, brain power on it. But correlation wise. On stiffness, we're really, really good. We can get within a fraction of a percent
Oh, wow.
On stiffness. So if we test something stiffness-wise, or if we do it in the computer, FEA would know that we get there testing-wise. Mm-hmm. Strength is a little worse. It can be 5 to 10%, maybe more. And impact tests are harder. They're the hardest ones, and we can be further off with those. But the other thing about FEA is you have to know how to use it, right? So if you understand there's limitations on the actual percentage, mm-hmm. right? If I look at my picture and say, so on FEA, if I understand that maybe we're not correlated to more than within 10 or 15% on this model, I can at least use it, take it into account, and know that, okay, maybe it's not giving me the exact right numbers, but generally, if I've got other things that are correct, it's telling me which areas are critical. And so I can make sure when I'm doing my layup design, I put more carbon in the areas where I need more carbon.
And then run it again.
You know you're on the right track.
Yeah, or just test it.
Okay, right.
And see what happens too, right? Testing is the end result, right? The final way.
The term layup design means like which parts of the bike you put how many layers of what types of carbon.
So I guess we should switch over to our carbon fiber 101.
Yeah, I guess so.
Lesson.
Yeah. Let's talk about carbon fiber. That's more your department, your composites guy.
Yep.
Because this is like working with carbon, like you say, extremely complicated for many, many reasons that a lot of people don't realize.
Yes.
Because we're thinking here, and I think that you'd probably be forgiven for thinking that, oh, F1, for like, you know, our core audience, an F1 car, whatever, you see pictures of big factories and cars are made by robots and whatever.
Exactly.
But that's like the furthest that it can be with working with carbon fiber.
Exactly.
So how do you get from bitumen or bamboo to something like this?
Well, let's talk about that. So this is, I give this course a lot because we're talking about carbon fiber bikes a lot in industry. People have this perception of what is carbon, right? So I'll skip over a couple of the slides here. You know, this is actually this bike, the RCS, the old paint job of it. And it's super light, super stiff. That's good, but we're gonna look at a couple things. So materials.
Maybe control this here.
Right. So generally, when you talk about materials, you're making something out of a material. Mm-hmm. There's three big properties that are important for structure, and it's density or weight, mm-hmm. right? Stiffness and strength. So density, obviously, this, I always use this analogy. What weighs more, a pound of lead or a pound of feathers?
The same.
Right? They're the same, but what's the difference in size, right? A pound of lead would be like, you know, this big.
Yeah.
A pound of feathers would be like this huge pillow.
Right.
Right. So, you want to use if you want to have lightweight things, mm-hmm. obviously like lightweight frames or Formula One cars or anything that's lighter, you need to use materials that have lower density, less weight for the same amount of material. Mm-hmm. Right. Stiffness and strength are great. I don't have them with me. I forgot to bring my pieces with me, but you can see on the screen, my favorite two props. Elastic band and spaghetti. I didn't bring spaghetti with me, but so just imagine if you take a piece of spaghetti mm-hmm. and you bend it a little bit, what happens?
Snap.
It's snap, right?
Wait, is it boiled first?
dry. Dry, yeah. Dry pasta. So pasta is quite stiff. Mm-hmm. Stiffness is how much something moves when you put a force on it, right?
Okay.
So something that's stiff, if I put a 1 pound force on this piece of bike, if I put a 1 pound force here, right, if it moves a little bit, we call it very stiff. If it moves a lot, we call it less stiff. So mm-hmm. stiffness is how much something moves with a given force.
Mm-hmm.
So the next one is strength. Strength is how much force takes to break something.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Right.
So if I put 10 pounds of this and it breaks, it's not very strong. If I put 500 pounds of this and it breaks, it's strong. So spaghetti is quite stiff. If you push on it, it won't move very much. But it's not very strong.
And right? when it does move, it breaks.
It breaks. Rubber band, on the other hand, mm-hmm. similar size to a piece of spaghetti. It's not very stiff. You just hold it up, it just flops down, right? But it's super strong. You can pull it for mm-hmm. ages before it actually breaks, right? So stiffness and strength are two different parameters, and we want good properties for both of them. Mm-hmm. So that's what carbon fiber is all about.
The modulus. Yep.
So we're... Yeah. This is
Before this interview, I did get a chance to read your white paper on modulus.
There you go.
Yeah, I read that too.
No, it was a great read, and like, yeah, you did bring up the spaghetti. And just if anybody is concerned, when things break, it's called fail. That's what they fail.
That's right. So my fonts are all messed up here because we don't have the right fonts on this, but.
Oh.
there's three main kinds of engineering materials we use for making stuff. Metals, mm-hmm. you have what's come with, right? You get some metals on the mic. Metals are very good because they're strong. They can be light, like aluminum is very lightweight. Steel can be heavy, right? Cast iron, quite heavy. Mm-hmm. But they're very good strength and good stiffness as well. And they're easily molded and formed in different shapes. You can weld them, you can do things, make them in different shapes, right? So that's right. why they're probably the most common material for almost everything we do. Plastics are another material. We use it for a lot of our little stuff, our mouse, all of our doodads and things we make. They don't have as much strength mm-hmm. as metals, but they are easily molded because you injection mold them and they're made very cheap and easy right. to make, high volume. They can be quite strong, but depends on the plastic. It's very variability, right? And they're lightweight and easy to manufacture and things like that. And they're recyclable too, as well, a little bit sometimes.
Very cheap.
That's a big driver for a lot of that. And then ceramics, like your mug or your glass. Right?
This is when we get to the things that are hard, but not.
They're hard strong. And brittle.
Yeah.
They're not super strong, but they're very stiff. But they fail differently. Metals fail in usually a ductile failure mode, right?
They soften. They soften.
Bends. It softens and bends. Ceramics fail in a brittle failure mode.
Explode. They get hard and explode. Yeah. They get hard
plastics
hard
can be explode. Either one. Depends on the plastic type. Mm. Some plastics have ductile failure, like your plastic pop bottles, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
You can't destroy that stuff, right?
Not even nature can. Thousands of years.
Yeah. But other plastics will snap, right?
Yeah.
It's too brittle.
Right.
So there's a fourth class of materials that we use a lot, and it's called composite materials. And composite material is made from two or more distinct components in one, kind of combined one material.
Okay.
So it's a composite of two things. Mm-hmm. It's not a single, like a metal is generally one thing. Now, okay, metals, you can argue they're alloys, which are generally different components, but on a macro scale, metals, plastics, and ceramics are all single components. Whereas composite materials are something made from two components, and they can have different properties based on which two components you choose.
Carbon fiber is a composite material.
Yes, we'll get there in a second.
Next sorry.
Two most common composites everyone knows about, wood and concrete.
Why is wood composite?
Wood is a composite. Wood is nature's original composite. Huh. How do you think trees grow to 200 feet tall and still stand up and don't blow over in the wind, right? Wood is actually, it's lignin fibers cellulose fibers in a lignin matrix.
Huh.
So the fibers are cellulose, which is film, used to be cellulose, celluloid, right? This comes from that kind of thing. So it's organic fiber. But they actually are fibers in a long direction. So the wood grows fibers along the tree trunk,
yeah.
right? So you think about wood, if you take a log and you want to chop it with an axe, if you lay the log down and cut across the fibers, how easy is that?
Not that easy.
You'd be sure. Hacking at the log all day, right? If you turn the log up on its end and cut in the direction of the fibers, they just peel apart.
Split them, yes.
Right? So that shows, it's called anisotropy, which is big word, doesn't matter. But basically, the properties are different in different directions.
Oh, okay.
Because the material.
Sorry, it's called what?
Anisotropy. It's anisotropic.
Anisotropic.
Material.
Okay.
Isotropic means it's the same in all directions.
Yeah.
Anisotropic is not the same in all directions. Okay. So metals are generally the same in all directions. Mm-hmm. I can take a piece of metal, and it doesn't matter if it's a block, which way I hit it, it's the same strength.
It's a mm-hmm. crystal.
It's a crystal structure. So the structure is homogeneous in all directions, generally. Yeah. You can change that with things like forging and how you make the part, but generally it's the same. Mm-hmm. Composites, especially ones with long fibers, like a wood, very much non-uniform. So very different properties in one direction than the other, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's carbon fibers the same way. Mm-hmm. Other one is concrete, right? Concrete is, it doesn't use fibers. It uses round stones. Mm-hmm. In cement, right? So concrete is, you know, but
the matrix would cement. Be the cement.
Matrix is, so cement holds the stones together. The stones reinforce it. Mm-hmm. And on the wood, the fibers get strength, and then the matrix holds the fibers together.
Okay. Right.
Concrete is much less anisotropic. It more uniform direction wise.
Right.
But they're definitely two distinct components, right? In each one.
Yeah.
So this is where I have this fancy question. It's not going to show up properly because the mess is all wrong. But what's carbon, right? I asked this question in the meeting when I gave this presentation.
Yeah.
What's carbon? Diamond's carbon. Coal is carbon. You want to buy something out of diamond? You're looking at the diamond? That's not made out of diamond, right?
And actually, okay, I just want to take a minute here right now, like a second, and like just specify that, because a lot of people use, especially in F1, use the term carbon way too loosely.
Exactly.
Carbon is just the 12th element of the periodic table.
Sixth element.
The sixth element. School was a
Go
while back.
Back to school.
But the sixth, yeah, that's all that carbon is. Carbon can come in many forms.
Exactly. This is my whole point. It's like, it can be diamond, right? I could build a big kind of diamond. It would be great. It would be super strong, but you probably couldn't afford it.
Yeah.
That's because of the beers.
Yeah. Exactly. coal is carbon, mostly, right? It's not very strong. You want to make money out of coal? Probably not. Yeah. Graphite, pencil called lentil lead, is not lead. It's just graphite, which is a form of carbon. It's sheets of carbon. It's like graphene, which you've heard of graphene, probably is very similar to that.
I actually wanted to ask you about graphene.
Oh, yeah, okay, we'll get there. graphite's not very strong at all. It's very weak in the plane direction. Right. So you don't want to make a bike out of those things, right? So what we use call carbon is actually carbon fiber reinforced plastic.
Oh,
right. So it's a composite plastic material, and it's made of two things: carbon fibers, so fibers, strands of carbon, in plastic. So this material we use for most of our bikes is epoxy. Mm-hmm. Most of the F1 cars are the same. Epoxy, you think of a 5-minute epoxy, you make 5-minute epoxy, you make two things, you mix them together, you squeeze it in 5 minutes, it hardens, it's plastic.
Yeah.
That's exactly what is in this bike and in all your F1 cars. And that what it is that epoxy holds the fibers together.
So if I could take the composite into its original parts for carbon fiber, I'd basically end up with like a pool of like clear like goop that hardens, and then what? Like what's the carbon part of it look like?
That's a good question. let's look at that. So so before we get to this next point here, this slide quickly is why we use carbon fiber. And this is a graph of stiffness to weight ratio.
Okay.
So stiffness for the same weight. What you can see is all the metals, titanium, aluminum, steel, chromoly, magnesium, and wood are about the same. Look at carbon fiber. That's why we use carbon fiber primarily. The stiffness to weight ratio can be, you know, 100 times or more better than...
Just to clear the terms up, what do you call pre-preg carbon fiber? That's where you order a sheet
that has
the resin.
Just wait. We'll get there. Okay. So what's carbon fiber? So that was a bit of an advance. It's basically a string, right? It's this. So if you look at this picture here, there's two ways you can make carbon fiber from rayon, which is basically polyester, plastic. Yeah. And what they do is they, on a machine on the left, they stretch out rayon fiber. Mm-hmm. And cook it, heat it up in an inert environment, in a vacuum. And plastics are mostly hydrocarbons, hydrogen, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, other things. Right. But if you take that fiber and you heat it really hot, everything else gets burned off. And you're left with just carbon. The carbon is the backbone of the rayon fiber. The other way is pitch. Pitch is actually tar. And they actually can spin it, and the same thing. And you make it into fiber and you burn it off. And pitch fibers have different properties than rayon fibers. But you see the size of those fibers from 7 to 10 microns. Look, so that red circle for information is a human hair. So that's how fine the fibers are.
Wow.
So, you know,
Have you played around with this stuff? Like, what does it feel like?
It's just like I had a sample box of stuff that I usually have for show and tell, and it's left in Italy somewhere. I'm trying to find it. So I couldn't bring it. Sorry.
That's what I wanted to see. But Cervelo's not, you're not weaving your own sheets of
carbon fiber.
Nobody does. Boeing does, right?
Boeing, no, they have suppliers, but they have big deals. They buy all the carbon, so they get what they want. But so carbon fiber, you basically make it string. It's a string. And carbon fiber is basically like it's like a fabric. So there's two kinds of ways. So you get the carbon, it comes in a string. When you get it in what's called a toe. Because, one carbon fiber is that small. You couldn't even see it if it was in your hand, one carbon fiber. Mm-hmm. So you can't handle that.
Yeah.
So a toe is basically a bundle of carbon fibers together that are kind of twisted a little bit so they stay in a string. So it's a string of carbon fibers.
Yeah.
And you may have heard the terms like 3K, 12K, 24K.
Yeah.
That's how many fibers.
Thousands of fibers.
Yeah, so 3K is 3,000 carbon fibers woven into a string.
Per string. It
could still be a few microns.
It's still a small string. Just a little string. So the
stronger?
There's not a hard and fast rule. Generally, more fibers, it's thicker piece. So it will generally be a little stronger, but it's also more dense. So it depends how you're using it. There's a bunch of factors around it. So you can't, there's no, you can't say, oh, it's always better to use 12K or always better to use, it depends.
Okay. Depends on the modulus.
Depends on lots of things. So there's two ways you can supply it. We supply, generally when you see carbon fiber, if you look at that, the round BB shell there, you see that pattern, right? That pattern, everyone says, oh, that's carbon fiber, right? That pattern.
Yes, this is, this looks like carbon fiber.
That is woven carbon fiber.
Okay.
Yeah.
And it's basically exactly what you do. It's a loom, you know, old school weaving. Kind of like your shirt and everything else.
Any of our shirts are made.
Everything fabric you have is made of cotton or whatever, both directions, weaving it.
Doing this, yeah.
Exactly. So that's, that look is woven. The other parts here, you see these bikes, this bike here, this is the actual carbon fiber finish on the outside. There's no pattern there, right?
What's
this? This is what's called unidirectional. So on woven, half the fibers go, you can see the picture, half the fibers go this way, this way. They go over top of each other, they're weaved around like this, right? Mm-hmm. And what that does is it makes it strong.
Makes it look really cool.
Makes it look cool. but it also makes it easy. Because if you think about, so other materials like aluminums and metals and stuff are the same properties in all directions.
Right.
Carbon fiber is very different. If you have all the fibers, so unidirectional is where all the fibers are running in one direction only. It's very different properties.
Strength.
So it's easier to like hack that and break it in one way versus another.
Yes. Okay. Very much so. So the woven stuff was actually started early. Carbon fiber was actually all done woven because it was easier to analyze, to deal with, because when you weave it together equally, it's roughly the same properties in the directions around in the plane. Whereas with unidirectional, it's much different. So woven makes it easier, but you lose properties. It's never going to be as stiff. The fibers are doing this. They're kinked, every single one of them. So they have strength because they're locked together, but they lose stiffness because the fibers are curved. And so when you pull on it, they'll kind of flatten out, and so it'll move.
Maybe a question related to this, or not, or I don't know if this is what they're doing, but the new Pagani Huayra.
Yes.
Huayra. And the hood, they did it so that all the fibers are like on kind of like a chevron pattern. Is that just for looks or like?
Yeah, mostly. I mean, it's probably woven like this, and you just put the woven on a 45-degree angle.
Okay.
Right? There is advantages to having 45-degree angles for things like torsion and twisting. A lot of our round tubes.
I was going
to
say, in the right light, you can actually see on that frame that the angle is sort
this
of
angle is
kind of curves
degrees.
Upwards, 45
These
degrees.
Fibers are 45, because what happens is 45-degree fibers work better. It's stiffer in twisting. Again,
you're putting the weight straight down on it.
I have my samples here. I don't have my samples, but I should show them to you. But we have these two twist sticks we bring for demonstration. The same is two little sticks of four layers of exact same carbon fiber. One of them has all fibers in the zero direction, so along the twist stick. Mm-hmm. And it's really stiff bending this way, but when you twist it, it's really twisty. The other one has fibers 40 plus or minus 45, so 45 degrees. It's really flexy in this direction, but really stiff in twisting.
So it's like a linguine and a rigatoni. Yeah,
exactly. But it's interesting because you have the exact same material, exact same shape, exact same amount of material.
This is where the fibers are pointing.
Completely different properties based on what the fibers are pointed at.
Wow. You have a really fun job.
It's complicated.
It sounds really fun.
So we, you know, part of the design is choosing what we use. So all of our bikes, generally we use unidirectional fibers because they're much stiffer in the direction we want, but it's harder to work with because you have to put them in the directions you need. Mm-hmm. We use woven. You can see on that bike over there, there's a patch on the top of the P5X.
Oh, yeah.
There's a patch of woven. We use that where we're cutting things. Woven has a more durability for cutting, so we've added woven there as a patch. But generally that one, again, you can see it's all 45s on the outside. So again, fibers, we'll talk quickly about that, but everyone says, oh, I'll just get a better fiber, a stiffer fiber, a stronger fiber, right?
Oh, wow.
So fibers you can buy, there's different properties based on the processing and all kinds of stuff. But there's these two parameters, are strength on the vertical and stiffness on the horizontal, right? And you can see something about the shape of that graph is that it goes this way, right? It's like an exponential graph.
And then kind of
you can never go up in both strength and stiffness. You either have more strength, but you lose stiffness, or you have more stiffness, but you lose strength. And so you can choose which fibers you want to use, but again, you have to make that choice. So you can choose a medium in the middle fiber and get kind of good stiffness and good strength. But if you want better strength, you choose a fiber with more strength, it's going to have way less stiffness. And so you also choose what kind of fibers you use. So we use like six different kinds of carbon fibers in this frame. We put high strength fibers where we need strength. We put high stiffness fibers where we need stiffness.
Are you using different sourced fibers as well in the same bike? Like, I know some are made from pitch, some are made from bamboo, some are made from...
Yeah, generally, most are made from rayon and pitch.
Polyethylene,
so pitch fibers are very, very high modulus, high stiffness. So we use those in this bike quite a bit. They're very, very fragile, very, very easily broken. So be careful where you use them.
No big jumps.
But it's combination. So we put some pitch fibers in critical areas with other fibers to help reinforce them. So the other fibers will carry the strength loads. So we use both. Yes.
Now, actually, that kind of goes with a question that I had, and it's reading your paper. The paper, it's easy to find. We'll put a link in the description of the video. But you're debunking the myth of the high modulus versus low, because pretty much anybody can make up. It's a marketing thing, right?
Exactly.
But there are different fibers that have different, like you said, it's strength versus stiffness. Am I just saying that right?
Yeah.
Exactly. And in a, like you just said, in a single like thing that I look at this, and this to me is one object. But in here, like you said, like it's there are like
500 pieces,
different little things, and when you, so just, and you do that for a purpose, right? Like, you know, you analyze it and you
exactly,
you figure out where it's gonna need to be stronger, whatever. That immediately, when I was reading the paper, it immediately made me think of an F1 wing, the wing of a car. And like, I imagine that it must be the same for them. They probably are using different kinds of fibers here and there.
They do a little bit. It surprised me with F1 from what I saw. I mean, we obviously weren't allowed to see all the stuff. It's all secret stuff, right? You can't see everything. But there's a lot of woven in F1.
Okay.
There's a lot of woven. I think it's because of... Woven lays up much easier in tools, especially when you have complex curve shapes and stuff. Woven with uni fibers, they're all running one direction. If you put them around a corner, they'll tend to split and fray, and it's really hard to put them in. Woven, because it's all kind of stays together like a fabric, it'll go in, right? Mm-hmm. So I think, I'm sure they use uni in some areas, but they use a lot of woven. Probably they're not as stiffness critical as some of our bikes, stiffness weight critical. And they have as much importance with strength and also with durability, right? Whereas woven will help you with that. So I think they use more woven than we think. The tubs, for sure. Tubs are a lot of uni. It's all very carefully, you know, optimized. Yeah. I think a lot of the other small parts, it's the impression I get in the small parts, is it's all about the aero is the number one driver, right? You need that new wing shape tomorrow for the next race. And so, you know, in reality, is it as stiff as they want to? Maybe not, but they got to make it in 3 hours. So this is what they do, right? Okay. They probably do analyze stuff and do a lot of this stuff, you know, that we're doing here. But from what I saw, I think it's probably focused a bit more on the speed to market of their parts, right? For them, that's absolutely critical, is getting stuff out fast.
Cool. You just mentioned small parts. Like, could something like this, which is a small, obviously strength-based piece, I guess, this is a brake mount, I guess?
That's
a gear mount?
Rear wheel hanger with a real rear mount.
Would something like this cost or take as much time as something like this?
No, the dropouts there, that's made from stacks of woven. Okay. You take a bunch of layers of woven, lay them up,
very solid,
squish them. It's a solid and it's compressed.
They seem almost similar weight, even.
Yeah, that drop is different.
It's
products,
lighter, but yeah.
And just before I let you go back, am I right to notice that it's kind of like tinfoil? It has like one side that's shiny and another side that's not, or is that just?
That one is purposely scuffed on the outside because it's bonded. Take that shell and bond it into the frame, glue it in, and so you scuff up. So the inside is that's tooled surface, so that comes off the tool. So that is how shiny it gets off a tool. So that's why the outside looks like this. It's shiny. This is actually
like,
painted.
It's got pressure. As a consequence of the pressure and temperature
on there, and the resin pushes to that surface, and you get it depends on how smooth your surface is in the tool. But the tooled surface ends up like this is natural as tooled surface, whereas the inside is rougher because the bag is in there.
I just brought that up because we went to the Infiniti dealership like a while back when they had an RB10 there.
And
we actually got really close and. At the back of it, it looked like it. All the carbon that they had that was exposed, it looked like this. It didn't look like the shiny bits. I don't know.
It could be how they molded it, right? I'm not sure if they molded it from tool on the other side, right? Which is, that's how they do it at F1. If they tool is male and they mold the outside, then the outside is going to be a rough surface.
Okay.
Maybe even for aero, like Red Bull had that matte paint that was sort of a rough, microscopically rough paint.
Yeah.
But anyway, yes, please, let's go.
Right, well, let's finish off before we run out of time here. So for fibers, as I mentioned, with my little stiffness things, right? Oop, I missed it there. So when you put the fibers in the direction with the loads, we call it 0 degrees, but along the direction of the load. So think of a beam. If you're bending we're bending this thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
Pushing down. If we put the fibers along this direction, they're very, very stiff.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're good stiffness and good strength. But they're not very good in, as I said before, twisting.
Oh.
The 45 degree, if you have orientation of 45 degree this way and this way, called plus or minus 45, that gives us good torsional stiffness and strength, but not so good bending. And so basically what we do is we go around the bike frame and look at all the loads we have in the bike and figure out to best rack those loads, where should we put these fibers? So we have fibers, you know, running along tubes to give stiffness against bending, but also 45 degree fibers to give stiffness against torsion.
Okay.
And so we have a whole ton of things like that. You actually see on this P5X here, there's a strip right here.
Yeah.
That's 0 degree fibers running along the chainstay to give stiffness in that direction. And we put that there on purpose on the outside. Whereas the other fibers, you can see the direction of them. They're 45 degree fibers.
Yeah. You can definitely see that.
Yeah. So So layup is all about figuring out how the loads are in a bike. So we did, here's just Meffier. I'll keep going here with some of these pictures. We'll skip that we talked about before. But basically, this is how we make a bike.
Mm-hmm.
We lay up on a mandrel, mm-hmm. so some kind of male tool that was removable later, or it can be right on the bladder. If we in California, we do a bladder, we fill it up with beads to salt solidify it and then lay up on the bladder, mm-hmm. empty the beads out, and then put it into the tool, mm-hmm. blow it up. But you're reinforcing local areas, right? We put fibers where you need them, so we need more strength, where we have bearings attaching, where we have interfaces, where we have the pedals attaching.
Mm-hmm.
We need more stiffness in some of the tubes, right? Some of these tubes here, lots of zeros. And you basically figure out, and it's, you know, it's kind of, we use the computer to help us, but it's a lot of trial and error in putting all the material in to make sure we meet all the load cases. We maybe have 30 or 40 different load cases we have to meet for strength and safety and stiffness, but then minimizing weight, right? So on this bike, the California bike we made a few years ago, we went through 116 prototypes.
Whoa.
Where we made the frame and broke it. Looked at what we failed, went back, changed the lip. We did, this is in combination, this is even with all the FEA stuff we do.
Wow.
We did hundreds of cases of FEA, but as you're doing it, you mm-hmm. learn more and more, right? So this one, we had to really push the weight limit. So, you know, at that point in time, we were trying to take out 2 grams, right? So a tiny piece of carbon fiber, 2 grams. So,
yeah.
You know, how do you, it's like really tough. Other bikes, we don't do nearly as many iterations because we don't have to push the weight that hard. Yeah, like
this might be 10 or 15 grams at least. Here,
exactly. It's more than that.
It's more, an ounce,
not,
maybe.
That's not from this bike.
Yeah, but yeah, just to give an example, exactly. Like a small piece like this is
over
20 grams.
We're fighting for grams. So, you know, it's really complicated. Right? We have, so on this bike, literally 500 pieces. On the P5X, we have probably 250 pieces.
Wow.
Every single piece of carbon fiber is put on by hand in the exact position. If you miss the position, if it's moved by a few millimeters, it's no good. All right, so part of this bike, one of the reasons this is so expensive is that we have no extra. Often when you're doing a bike, you'll put extra material. So if it's off position by a few millimeters, it's still okay.
Still
so you make
strength,
the piece a little bit bigger, so it won't, if it moves a little bit, it's okay. This bike, we're going to minimize that, but that means we have to take way more time and care putting the pieces down because there's no extra. If it moves by 2 millimeters, the frame is junk.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
Right? So
that's the level of precision.
It's super precision. The same thing when we were, you know, with the GB bike and Lent, the same thing. It's like lots of pieces put down very, very accurately every time, right? And it's all done by hand. So this is all, you know, you don't see it. You think, oh, yeah, I just pops out of a mold somewhere.
Of course. That's...
But most of the work in our bikes is hand labor. Someone putting the carbon fiber pieces. So the sheets, so you mentioned earlier with prepreg, right? The carbon fiber comes as carbon fiber, just fibers.
Mm-hmm. Right.
you can make it that way and just put resin into it later, like 5-minute epoxy. You can do that. There's different ways you make it. But generally, the most common way for aerospace, Formula One, for us and bikes, is prepreg, where it's short for pre-impregnated. We basically take rows of carbon fiber and put resin in it already at the right amount. And then you have to store it in a freezer so it won't cure. So the resin is like a 5-minute epoxy, but it's like 6-hour epoxy. And it cures only at high temperature. So at room temperature, it'll cure slowly, but you have to store it in the freezer. So you keep it in the freezer, which makes it very kind of stiff and hard to work with. But then you cut out the pieces, but it's already been mixed, the two parts. So basically you take it and then just heat it up and it cures. So we think about this. We have like many, many layers of carbon fiber. We have to push them all together because if you have gaps between the layers,
yeah,
then it doesn't work very well. So you need to compact them. That's what the pressure is for, the autoclave or the bladder inside. Pushes the layers really hard together. That's the most important thing, is to crush them together.
Yeah.
So when they cure, it's one solid piece, like you can see here. Like
bake
the wall
in the stiffness
is,
to it.
Yeah. Right. If there was gaps in there and the thing wasn't pushed properly, it would be crappy stiffness. So that's basically how you do it. You put that in there. You cook it for, usually it's 40 minutes to an hour. Depends on the epoxy type.
Mm-hmm.
You pull it out, and then you do some post-processing. Often our bikes are made in pieces.
Yeah.
The P5X is made in one piece. But the T5GB and the RC and most of our other bikes are made in multiple pieces and bonded. So you can see this here. This is a chainstay piece. It's just cut up, but this would be kind of bonded in to another part of the bike, right? So you'd bond things together because you can't, especially with the rear end on this bike, right? To make a tool that gets all this in one piece, it's tricky. You can do it. We've done it before, but it's tricky.
Yeah.
So it's simpler to make a tool for
you
this.
You can do it. You'd rather not.
Yeah. It's all trade-off. So I think that's kind of my carbon fiber 101 summary. If that makes sense. But I think it's important thing for people to remember that people say carbon all the time, but it's not just carbon. It's carbon fiber reinforced plastic.
My God, like from where I started in terms of what I knew and what I thought I knew until like now after your talk, like I have a way, way better understanding. And honestly, thank you for that. We are running out of time, I guess. But real quick. Is there something in terms of materials engineering and things like graphene or whatever that are starting to pop up right now that excites you for the future?
Beyond steel, aluminum, titanium, carbon fiber, what's next?
I don't know. There hasn't been a lot of movement in materials in a long time. I started off
virtual bikes.
I started my master's degree in composites, and at that time, there's a lot of other fibers that were being looked at, weird, crazy stuff. You know, you've seen things like Kevlar, that bike that fork has Kevlar, that yellow fiber on top is Kevlar.
Oh, really?
Right? Okay. Like in bulletproof vests. Because it has proper, good, really durable, it stays together really well. It's not very stiff, but it stays together well. If that breaks, it will stay together. So we have it there. So there was a lot of research into fibers kind of the 70s and 80s, and it really died down. It was all in aerospace, and the focus got pushed since then really into commercializing carbon. And so carbon is really taken over. I don't see yet anything else coming in that's the next great thing. It's way better.
Graphene
is interesting in some ways. It's really hard to make a macro scale piece of graphene. Like graphene is right because it's super strong in the plane. But how do you make a, you know, infinitesimally thick plane into a part? As soon as you make it thicker, it just turns into graphite, and then you've got the thing that's just going to slip apart and break. It's no better than carbon, really. Yeah. So you know, it has properties for things like coatings, where you have a surface of that or coating of that, maybe, or electrical properties, right? But structurally, I don't see it being – it's. I haven't seen stuff. We've seen and heard about nanotubes and things, right? There's some small things, but we have not yet seen any magic new material yet.
So for now, carbon is king.
This is the
carbon is king, and it's all about there's getting better carbons all the time, and about processing and about manufacturing, getting it, making it better, designing it better, using the carbon you have better. That's where the gains are for now. Eventually, you'll get more.
One quick question. I saw something about Cervelo, but the way that you interface carbon with something like this, where the wheel is mounted, a piece of aluminum. That there is maybe fiberglass here. Is there some kind of weird thing with carbon fiber touching metal? Do they interact?
Yeah, there can be called galvanic corrosion.
I thought galvanic wasn't between two metals.
So it's any galvanic cell, which is just two materials that have different electrical properties, right?
So you have one small sheet of fiberglass.
So we use a glass. It's just a glass fiber. Yeah. So again, fiberglass is fiberglass composites. Glass fibers in usually it's polyester or epoxy.
Like this.
It's exactly glass right there. So we use a glass scrim. If we have bonding of metal to carbon, we'll put glass in between there.
Okay.
It's not that big of a deal.
It feels like it's one piece. Like you can't.
Yeah, it's molded as one piece. Right, the glass is it's all molded as one piece.
It's incredible. Yeah.
Yeah. Cool. Cool. That's the point. So yeah, I mean, hopefully it's
this piece 295.4 grams.
If
you can imagine that.
If I'm to read that properly, we're 2 minutes between now and you getting a ticket. Let's close it at this point. Thanks everybody for watching. Thank you so much. Loved all
this
stuff that you brought.
Cérvelo online.
www.cérvelo.com.
And your closest high-end bike shop. Exactly. Do not bring anything less than a few grand.
Well, thanks for having me, guys. Appreciate it. It's been fun.
Thanks
for coming.
Thanks,
we
everybody.
Appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you.